Hi everyone. Today we're going to continue with our structural dynamics theory videos, and today we're going to include damping into our single degree of freedom systems dynamic behavior. So the title of this video is Damped Free Vibration of Single Degree of Freedom Systems. So what is different between this video and the previous one? In the previous one, we said it was undamped, so there's no friction or there's no air resistance, so there's nothing to stop our motion. And today we're going to include some damping, and we're going to see what happens. We are still in free vibration, so no external force, and we are still considering just a single degree of freedom. So everything is described by just a single number. The first concept we need to introduce is the definition of viscous damping. So viscosity in materials just means that the properties change depending on the velocity in which you apply the loads. So what this means in terms of dynamic systems, that means the damping that our system provides is proportional to the velocity of the mass itself. So in terms of equation, that just means that our damping force is going to be proportional to the velocity, and C is some sort of damping coefficient. So imagine that our mass is moving to the right, which is not the same as having the mass on the right side. In this case, the velocity is to the right. So that means that that damping force has to go through the left, right? The same way friction works in a car or air resistance. If you're moving in front, the force of friction is basically braking your car, right? That means that the damping force has a minus sign with respect to the velocity, and we can also write the velocity as the first derivative of position. Now consider the mass from the previous video, and on top of the elastic force provided by the spring, we have now a damping force of minus C times x dash, so times the velocity written as the derivative of position. If we take second Newton's law and say the sum of forces have to be equal to ma, we get to the dynamic equation of equilibrium for a damped free vibration system. So it's exactly like the previous one, but now we add this term of damping times velocity. Before we continue, I just want to show you this little picture, which shows up in lots of books. So if you see books, you're going to see this picture. This little device here it's a damper, or it's supposed to be a damper. So it's very common that you see this in books. What it means is that in a dynamic system, you have mass, you have stiffness, and you have damping. So I just wanted to mention this before we continue. Now let's look into the solutions of this dynamic equation of equilibrium. And the reality is there are three different solutions for this equation. Now, the three different solutions depend on something that we call the critical damping. So it's something that, again, is natural to your structure. The critical damping is 2 times the mass times the circular natural frequency. And it's also common to, instead of writing the critical damping, we write the damping ratio zeta. So that is the damping that we have in our structure, C, okay, the amount we have of damping, divided by the critical amount. And this gives you in percentage how much damping you can have. Now, depending on this damping ratio, we have three types of equations of motion. And those are the trace solutions that we have for this dynamic equation of equilibrium. If our system is underdamped, that means if our damping ratio is less than one, or our damping coefficient is less than the critic, we have something that is called an underdamped system. When the damping ratio is equal to one, or the damping coefficient gets equal to the critical one, we get a critically damped system, and over that, we call it an overdamped system. We're going to look into the equations. Don't worry if they look too complicated. The idea is just for information, and then we're going to see what is that we need to understand very well. So consider first the underdamped system. We have two equations of motion similar to the previous video, one written according to the initial position and initial velocity, and one written according to the amplitude, and they're equivalent. They have the same meaning. So this equation of motion looks like the other one, just has this extra term. And we're going to explore this extra term more in the next slide. If we look into the critically damped system, what is very interesting about this one is that it still has this e to the minus something, and it has some sort of amplitude, but, and that's important that you understand this, it does not have a cosine wave. So the critically damped system is the one that does not oscillate, is the first one that does not oscillate. So when we have, let's say, a damping ratio of 0.99, we still have a little bit of oscillation. And when it gets exactly to one, we lose the oscillation. And this is also valid for the overdamped system. I don't want to show you the equations again. That's not the main idea. I'll put them in the description if you are curious and if you need to code them in some of the applications that you need to use in the future. Now, why am I not very curious about these two systems? The damping ratios for structures usually sit around 0.5 to 5%. So in terms of damping ratio, we're looking at 0.05, maybe 0.1, but definitely not close to a critically damped system or an overdamped system. So we're going to basically be looking a lot into this equation, and we're going to forget about this too. But please remember that critically damped system is the first system that does not oscillate. Let's explore the equation of motion of an underdamped system. The first term, and the most important one in this video, is this exponential term that we're going to call it the exponential decay. The equation also has an A0, which is the amplitude, same as the one that we saw before in the undamped case. And we also have some sort of wave that defines the harmonic motion. Another thing that is interesting is this omega d, we call it the damped frequency, and it's equal to the natural circumnatural frequency times square root of 1 minus the damping ratio squared. So let's look into an example, same example as we did in the previous video, mass of 2 tons, stiffness of 8 kilonewton per meter, which gives us a circumnatural frequency of 2 radians per second. If we assume, for example, a damping ratio of 2%, so 0.02, the damped circular natural frequency transforms into 1.9996. So even though this makes a difference, the difference is not that big. We could very well say that the damping circular natural frequency is the same as the natural one. Now, let's plot this equation, assuming that the amplitude is 1 and that the phase angle is 0. So we can first note that the amplitudes reduce. So A1, A2, and A3, we see a reduction of amplitude, which again makes sense now that we're considering damping. Our amplitude reduces because there is friction, there is something to reduce the energy of our system. Another thing that is important to remember is that the line that connects these amplitudes is given by this exponential decay, okay? So if you consider just that bit, you get an exponential curve that follows the maximum amplitudes of your vibration. Now, it's difficult to see the exponential in this case, but now let's consider an example with a damping ratio of 10%, which is already very, very high for a structure. And even in this case, the damped frequency would be 1.99 radians per second. So we're not talking about a big difference in terms of the frequency of the structure, even when we add quite a substantial level of damping. If you see now the two curves plotted together, the exponential decay and in blue the equation of motion, you can see that the amplitudes reduce a lot faster. Even though 10% doesn't sound like a lot, it does create a massive difference in the dynamic behavior of our structures. Now, let's consider something interesting. We just found out that this exponential decay gives you the change of amplitudes of your motion. So if we take time to be a full period, so if we substitute time to be the natural period of your structure, you can get this equation, which is quite useful, that it's the ratio between successive amplitudes, if we call it this amplitude 0 and this amplitude 1, the ratio between A1 and A0 is given by the exponential decay when t equals the natural period. And this is quite a useful equation. So let's see another slide to rewrite this and say for consecutive peaks, and by the way, this is also valid between A2 and A1 or between A3 and A2. So between consecutive peaks, we can say that the ratio of amplitudes is given by this factor. But we can also write that for non-consecutive peaks, we just have to multiply the period by the number of periods in between those waves, right, in between those peaks. So we have quite a useful way to measure the damping in our structures. And this is done through an equation that is called the logarithmic decrement of damping of a structure. So if we measure the amplitudes at different times and we know how many waves we had in between, and that's defined by this m, we can calculate this delta quantity, 1 over m, times the natural log of the ratio of the amplitudes. And then if we divide by 2 pi, we get a damping ratio. So this is really important for engineering, because if we have a structure and we don't know how much damping we can rely on, we can actually measure that quantity. We go to the structure, we excite it, we measure the difference in amplitudes, and then we use this calculation to understand how much damping we can trust. In summary, We looked into the dynamic equation of equilibrium and we added a c times x dash term, which is the damping term. So damping coefficient times the velocity written as the derivative of position. We also looked into the equation of motion and added this central term, this exponential, this negative exponential that we call the exponential decay. And we looked into what it means. And then we use the exponential decay as a method to find out how much damping we have in our structures and obtain that experimentally based in a method called the logarithmic decrement of damping. So it's important to have these equations in the back of your mind and know how to apply them. And it's also important to understand what the logarithmic decrement is for. Thank you for watching and have a good one.